The Politics program is brought to you, as always, by Patreon.com/JURY. Hey, look. March. Jury in your house tour taking place in March. If you want your city to be in the running, if you want to, well, technically, if you want to host me in your living room, I'll be happy to come. It's going to be in March. You better let me know if you are into it. Email justinrobertyoung@gmail.com. Meanwhile, if you want to support the show, then go ahead and throw me a ducat. Patreon.com/JURY. Patreon.com/jury. You get two shows for the price of one. This show, as well as Jury, my one mic show where I answer your emails. So go ahead and check it out. Patreon.com/JURY. And stickers or DIAF, get new sticker packs from me and Ashley Paramore, my wife. We got the holiday bundle that is going to get reshuffled at the end of this week. So please go ahead and get your stickers while you can. That includes the Ruin'em sticker, the wine label. Once they're gone, they're gone. We can never remake those. Those are the original wine labels. They are available right now in the holiday pack, stickers or DIAF. But enough of how we support the show. What do you say we just do the damn thing? Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, my good God damn. Allow me to apologize to you. Me, Justin Robert Young, needs to apologize to you. I owe you an apology. Longtime listeners to this show will remember that there was a point when the election was over when I was hemming and hawing. It's a good way to describe it. Hemming and hawing. I thought that the world was desolate. I thought that we would never have another fun story, because as I lectured you from my ivory tower, plebs, elections are more fun than governing. What am I going to talk about? What am I going to talk about? What am I going to talk about? Well, ladies and gentlemen, when you put your faith in the Lord, then God provides. I decided to keep this show going, and I would like to apologize for ever doubting manna from heaven. Oh, because this last 24 hours, oh, politics, new favorite day is yesterday and this morning, and it has everything. Journalism screw-ups, hilarious personal details, salacious rumors, backbiting press conferences, media people covering their butts. Ooh! Ooh! I'm so excited! And I just can't hide it! I'm about to lose control, and I think I like it. Where do we start? I just want to know, where do we start? Okay, let's start in chronological order, because, well, actually, here, let's start here. Here are things we're not going to talk about. I'm just not going to talk about them. The confirmation hearings, I'm not going to talk about them. I'm sorry. If you want, you want another show that talks about this stuff seriously, just go talk. Go somewhere else, man. Find them. I kind of hate confirmation hearings because really, it's like every senator. Watch these confirmation hearings and tell me if you don't think this is true. Every senator is just trying to get their gif moment. So it's like they ask a leading question. Do you think that chocolate is better than vanilla? And then the confirmation person's like, well, at this time, I would believe that, yes, chocolate is better than vanilla. And then, like, the senator just takes this big turn toward the camera and just goes like, And it's so they can use it in political ads, and it's so they don't get made fun of, and it's so in future races, they're not supposed to, like, you know, they don't get it held against them. And listen, it's not without its worth. I thought Marco Rubio... Wait, who? Who? I mean, there's the senator. Who's the senator from Florida? The senator from Florida, he ran for president. You know, he was, what was his name? What was his name? God damn it. I can't even remember it. I can't even remember that his name was. Marco! Long way to go for that. He had a good moment today with Rex Tillerson, basically towing the Republican Warhawk line. It's fine. That's it. I wanted to yell Marco Rubio, and that's pretty much it that I wanted to do with the confirmation hearings. It's not to say they're not important. I'm just not going to talk about them. There's better people to talk about them. I'm the best person to talk about all the other dumb stuff that happened. Here's something else I'm not going to talk about. I am not going to talk about the Barack Obama address. From what I saw, it looked beautiful. Everybody I know that was a fan of Obama thought it was great. The biggest criticism I saw was like, hey, man, this is a lot of really eloquent yet poignant race talk that would have been nice in the last 8 years. But other than that, it seemed like a very moving farewell address. And I saw, you know, a lot of people, especially in the light of what we are going to talk about, felt that this was a very poignant, almost eclipse kind of moment where all of a sudden the light was blocked out. So, what are we going to talk about? Well, we're going to talk about this in chronological order because this is how I experienced it. Yesterday, afternoon time, probably afternoon Pacific. So we're saying 3 o'clock, right? 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, something like that. CNN releases the following story. Here is the story. Headline, Intel chiefs press Trump with claims of Russian efforts to compromise him. Bylined on this, Evan Perez, Jim Sciutto, Jake Tapper, and Carl Bernstein. The two names that stick out the most are Jake Tapper and Carl Bernstein. Jake Tapper, of course, is the CNN anchor. Carl Bernstein did a little piece of journalism. You might know it. It's called Watergate. Pretty good. Pretty good stuff from old Carl. Let's read the lead. Classified documents presented last week to President Obama and President-elect Trump included allegations of Russian operatives claimed to have compromising personal and financial information about Mr. Trump. Multiple U.S. officials with direct knowledges of the briefings tell CNN. The allegations were presented in a two-page synopsis that was appended to a report on Russian interference in the 2016 elections. The allegations came in part from the memos compiled by a former British intelligence operative whose past work with U.S. intelligence officials consider credible. The FBI is investigating the credibility and accuracies of this allegation, which are based primarily on information from Russian sources, but has not confirmed many essential details in the memos about Mr. Trump. All right. All right. All right. All right. All right. Let's go ahead and break it down. Do me a favor and reach in your coat, bring out your X-ray specs, put them on your face, and let's read again. The allegations were presented in a two-page synopsis, which was appended to a report in a Russian interference in the 2016 election. This is them covering their ass to say that our sources are telling us exactly how this information got in to the sphere. The allegations came in part from memos compiled by a British intelligence operative whose past work U.S. intelligence officials consider credible. When I first read this, this kind of raised a red flag in my head. Because when you are that sure exactly where stuff came from, very often you know what they are talking about. The FBI is investigating the credibility and accuracy of these allegations, which are based primarily on Russian sources, but has not confirmed many essential details in the memos about Mr. Trump. This is a key sentence. This is a very key sentence. Because this basically says that what we are reporting is that there is a memo that says things that may not be true. But the newsworthiness of this is that there is a memo that says things. Now, let me see if I can find this sentence that actually set me off. It basically says... All right, so this has been updated after what happened. Basically, in their original reporting, CNN says that they knew what was in the allegations and they would not report. They would not report what was in the allegations because they were unable to verify them. This raised a very big red flag to me. Because when I looked on CNN... I saw four very solemn faces, all four names that are on this story, including Jake Tapper and including Carl Bernstein. Carl Bernstein, especially when you were talking about deep reporting on presidents, has the gold standard legacy. Watergate made him the name on this, along with Bob Woodward. So it seemed weird to me that CNN would not report on what was in memos that apparently the FBI and the CIA are taking credibly. That seemed weird. It seemed weird to me. Because by my gauge... And the fuck do I know? I'm a jack-off who does a podcast, so take it for what it's worth. You don't report on this story until you can bring the receipts. If you have the memos and you feel uncomfortable publishing them, then what's the sense of reporting on their shadow? Wait until you have somebody from the FBI... to go on record or off record to say, these are true. We have credible evidence to believe that these are true. There's also another great line here, and I can't find it again. But basically, it was this great line where it's like, we have had this corroborated by government sources, intelligence sources, White House sources, and sources from the private sector. Which is an amazing way to say unnamed source, right? We have six different ways that we can say unnamed source. Unnamed source, unnamed source, unnamed source, unnamed source. That's great. We can figure out all these different nicknames for it. Now, here's why things blew up so quickly after this. It's because CNN does have these memos. CNN did have these memos, and so did a lot of other people. In fact, as we found out, these memos were initially crafted by Never Trump people. That work wound up then going to the Hillary campaign. That work wound up becoming, as intelligence officials got more and more worried about Donald Trump, they crossed their desk. And so now they were like, okay, let's investigate this. They hire the guy who wrote it, a former MI6 agent. And now that's why what started out as freelance opposition research against Donald Trump now becomes an intelligence community investigation. But these memos are not secret. Mm-mm. CNN didn't want to report them. But guess who did? Guess who did? I'll give you a quiz about it, and answer number three will shock you. Folks, it's BuzzFeed. Oh. Now, BuzzFeed has gotten the shit kicked out of them in the last 24 hours, but I'm going to go ahead and defend them after we get to the good part. They run this memo, a dossier making explosive but unverified allegations that that the Russian government has been cultivating, supporting, and assisting President-elect Donald Trump for years and gained compromising information about him, has been circulating among elected official intelligence agents and journalists for weeks. The dossier, which is a collection of memo written over a period of months, includes specific, unverified, and potentially unverifiable allegations of contact between Trump aides and Russian operatives. The graphic claims of sexual acts. The what now? The what? The what? The sexual acts. Oh, we read on. BuzzFeed News reporters in the U.S. and Europe have been investigating various alleged facts in the dossier, but have not verified or falsified them. CNN reported Tuesday that a two-page synopsis of the report was given to President Obama and Trump. Now, BuzzFeed News is publishing the full document so that Americans can make up their own minds about allegations about the president-elect that have circulated at the highest levels of government. This has been touched up since yesterday. I really wish I would have, save that. Then it goes on to report all the stuff that's happened since. So let's go ahead and get on into this. Let's get on into this, huh? Huh? What do you say we get a little old look on into this this memo? Boring, 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 boring. Kremlin's been feeding Trump and his team valuable intelligence on his opponents, including Democrat presidential candidate Hillary Clinton. Yeah. Kremlin's cultivation observation in Trump also compromised him offering lucrative real estate development business deals in Russia. Yeah. Trump has not taken any of them. Okay. Boring. Born fruit. Exploit Trump's personal obsessions and sexual perversions. Sexual perversions! Oh, dear, read on. Read on. There were aspects to Trump's... This is from the memo. There were aspects to Trump's engagement with the Russian authorities, one of which has borne fruit for them was to exploit Trump's personal obsessions and sexual perversions in order to attain suitable compromising material on him. According to Source D, where she or he had been present, Trump's perverted, in parentheses, conduct in Moscow included hiring the presidential suite of the Ritz-Carlton Hotel, where he knew President and Mrs. Obama, in parentheses, whom he hated, had stayed at one of their official trips to Russia, and defiling the bed where they had slept by... All right, everybody, just please, if you have kids in the car, please let them know that this is normal. This is totally normal. This is the new normal. I'm going to read this sentence, and I'm going to read it slowly. I will then read it in as many voices as you guys want. Please just write them in the chat room. He employing a number of prostitutes to perform a golden showers, parentheses, urination show in front of him. As Hulk Hogan.
Well, let me tell you something, brother. It was the bed that President and Mrs. Obama had stayed on one of their official trips to Russia, brother, and defiling the bed where they had slept by employing a number of prostitutes to perform a golden showers urination show in front of them, brother.
As Jar Jar Binks.
Woo! Misa defiling the bed that had slept in employing a number of prostitutes to perform golden shower show in front of him. Woo!
As Rush Limbaugh. I don't know if he's going to read it, but you're going to hear it here.
On one of their official trips to Russia, defiling the bed where they had slept by employing a number of prostitutes to perform a golden showers urination show in front of him. The hotel was known to be under FSB control with microphones and concealed cameras in all the main rooms to record anything they wanted to.
As R.L. Stine.
In the Ritz-Carlton Hotel, where he knew President and Mrs. Obama had stayed on one of their official trips to Russia, and defiling the bed where they had slept by employing a number of prostitutes to perform a golden showers urination show in front of him.
And finally, as Barack Obama.
Well, as where he knew me and Michelle, whom he hated, had stayed on one of their official trips to Russia and defiling the bed where they had slept by employing a number of prostitutes to perform a golden showers urination show in front of them. Well.
Love it. Important questions. Did he sleep in the bed afterward? Also, did he have sex with the hookers, or did he just get the hookers there to pee on stuff? Also, if he got the hookers just to pee on stuff, why not just pee on it himself? Also, did he think that they were going to come back to sleep in the bed? Did he, like, sneak in when they were off getting some borscht? This basically erupts into hilariousness on Twitter for the rest of the day.
Jack Devaney in the Twitch chat, did he pay for the whole hour? Right? Why would he have sex if he could just see him pee? Good point. It doesn't look like he got peed on or he peed on them, according to this memo, which, by the way, let's remember this, was reported by CNN on a solemn panel, including a stern-faced Jake Tapper and the gold standard of presidential scandals, Carl Bernstein. It was reported on CNN like this was big breaking news, the final piece of the puzzle piece that's been missing this entire time. Why is Trump soft on Russia? Why did the DNC get hacked but not the RNC? Why did Donald Trump win? Why did Hillary lose? Why? It's all answered here. He's been compromised. They have financial dealings on him. They've been feeding him information. They've got a lawyer that went to Prague that connected with the Russian government. This is the Rosetta Stone for any and all thoughts we have on Donald Trump. When CNN reports, again, let's look at this CNN headline. This CNN headline is Intel Chiefs presented Trump with claims of Russian efforts to compromise him. So put on your X-ray specs and tell me what that really says. That really says, Donald Trump, there is increasing evidence that Donald Trump is a puppet of the Russian government. That's what that says. So, we go from that to this. Golden showers. And there's a lot more in here. And it's definitely worth reading. But I am 100%, 100% down with BuzzFeed covering this. As I said on Twitter, there's good news here for Donald Trump. Number one, R. Kelly's now totally down to play the election. He peed on people. Oh, my God. All right. So let's get serious. Darkwing Duck style. Or maybe that was dangerous. BuzzFeed got hammered for this. BuzzFeed, like, it was like, oh, my God, it's a breach of ethics. Oh, my God, how could you possibly run this? This is a lot of just really wild stuff. This is terrible. This is awful. You can't do this. Nobody can report this. Nobody can say that this is verifiable. Unless you have the evidence, then why are you putting this up on the internet? No. CNN does not get to tut-tut BuzzFeed, in my opinion. Because CNN ran the shadowy outline of something gigantic, something that is credibility eroding for an incoming president. And I am all for that kind of reporting. You should be going after Donald Trump. You should be going after his ties to Russia. You should be finding out every little dirty detail, especially if it includes Donald Trump hiring Russian prostitutes to pull the old reverse Bellagio on a Ritz-Carlton bed in Moscow. Okay? But you gotta bring the receipts. And if you were not gonna bring the receipts and you were just gonna let it linger out there and just say, well, we can't report it, but look, all these people, FBI, CIA, intelligence committee, the White House, the outgoing president, they're all concerned about this. We won't tell you what it is, but they're all concerned about it. You should be concerned that they're concerned because they're concerned about this thing. If you're going to let that linger out there, then I'm sorry, man. BuzzFeed had to bring the receipts. BuzzFeed had to do it because guess what? Now there's a lot of reporting on this. Now the New York Times has their own deep dive on it. Now a lot of the pieces of this, and this is, again, raw data, i.e. not confirmed. These are leads to be followed up on. New York Times says Donald Trump's lawyer was never in Prague. It was a different dude. 4chan says that the whole hooker peeing thing was a hoax that they made up and fed to somebody months ago. So I'm sorry. Like, if BuzzFeed ran this out of the blue, it'd be screwed up. But when one of the most respected television news networks, which is in and of itself an oxymoron, when they come out and want to act like they just published the Pentagon Papers, nah, I'm cool with it. I'm cool with them running it. I'm cool with Donald Trump torching him for it. I'm cool with everything that happened, except for CNN running the story. Either you got it or you don't. But understand, and this is what I want you guys to get through your head, right? Because this is what gets lost. This headline, Intel chiefs present Trump with claims of Russian efforts to compromise him. That is talking about our favorite sentence ever. About Trump's perverted conduct in Moscow included hiring the presidential suite of the Ritz-Carlton Hotel, where a new president and Mrs. Obama, whom he hated, had stayed at one of their official trips to Russia, and defiling the bed where they had slept by employing a number of prostitutes to perform golden shower shows in front of him. Like, that is what that headline's about. You would not know that if CNN had just run their story and they had the last word. You would not know that it was about that, but it's about that. Intel chiefs present Trump with claims of Russian efforts to compromise him. This is CNN. Equals Trump's perverted conduct in a Moscow Ritz-Carlton included the hiring of the presidential suite and two Russian hookers, where they defiled the bed that they had slept on by employing a number of prostitutes to perform golden showers urination shows in front of him. I mean, come on! Come on! Like, how? This is insane! And see, and BuzzFeed has to eat the poop! BuzzFeed has to eat the poop! Which, thankfully, it didn't go any further. There was any actual poop eating in these allegations. So you want to know what? Like, again, there's, all right, so all this happens. I'm getting caught up. All this happens. And in the specter of everything is the fact that Donald Trump's going to have his first press conference since he won the election this morning. Within 12 hours of this, 18 hours of this breaking, right? So, of course, previewing all of this, we do one of our favorite little segments. Our favorite little segments, which is, what did Donald Trump tweet? Let's go ahead and take a look. Here we go. Let's start out. This is the first thing. Fake news, a total political witch hunt. All right. Cool. Donald J. Trump retweets Michael Cohen, his lawyer that was apparently alleged to be in Prague. He says, I've never been to Prague in my life, and shows his passport. Does not show inside of his passport, probably wisely. Donald Trump tweeting an article from lifezet.com. You know, get it how you live it. BuzzFeed runs unverifiable Trump-Russia claims, #fake news. And here comes the tweet storm. Russia just said the unverified report paid for by political opponents is, quote, a complete and total fabrication, utter nonsense, very unfair. I mean, I was wrong 1.5 million times on this election. So, I'm not an expert. But I would say that if you're trying to distance yourself from the allegations that you're a puppet of Russia, I probably wouldn't lead with Russia said. But hell, you're president. I'm an asshole with a podcast. He goes on. Russia has never tried to use leverage over me. I have nothing to do with Russia. No deals, no loans, no nothing. That's all in caps. And of course, I win an election easily. Dubious. A great movement, quote, like movements in quotes. Like, you know, it's a movement. Sure. Right. You don't have to put it in quotes. A great movement is verified. And crooked opponents try to belittle our victory with fake news. A sorry state. And here's the piece de resistance. Intelligence agencies should never have allowed this fake news to leak into the public. One last shot at me. Are we living in Nazi Germany? Oh, how could I ever think? How could I have ever doubted? This is why I have to apologize to you. This is why I have to apologize. Right? Because how could I think that this was going to be anything other than Mr. Toad's Wild Ride? Gambling Man in the chat says, would you describe this then as your struggle? Maybe Mein Kampf? It's unfair. Unfair. But he's the one who brought up Nazi Germany. Also, I'm going to go ahead and debate this is one last shot, right? I mean, dude, you're about to be president. You're about to work with these people. Do you think that this is the first time that intelligence people have leaked stuff against an administration? Because I don't. I think that they leak stuff all the time. You will have many more shots from the intelligence community. It is like, you know, a lot of people, it is not, not original to compare Donald Trump to an internet commenter. But it is extra sweet that he did, just reinforce Godwin's law. I do like that. I very much like that. I think that that's great. So then we come to the press conference. And the press conference initially scheduled to be about Trump's conflict of interest, how he is going to disentangle himself from his various business interests when he assumes the role of president. Now, I don't look at this antagonistically for Trump, but I do think that it's unique. We've never, ever, ever elected somebody with this kind of history in the private sector. We've never, ever, ever elected somebody without previous governmental experience that's never been vetted before. You know, if you run a chain of Piggly Wigglies and then run for governor, usually when you're governor, you got to figure out this disentanglement thing. You know, there's levels. If you just walk in from the private sector to the largest office, it's going to be more complicated. And it's going to be more complicated than we've ever seen before. Because we've never done it. We have no precedent. So we're going to have to make it up as we go along. Yeah. Fritz says Carter had a peanut empire, but he held a lower level of government before he ran for president. So, press conference starts. Donald Trump's got a bunch of big, gigantic piles of paperwork that he's going to have his lawyer come out later in the press conference and explain, how they're going to disentangle themselves. I do actually have to apologize to CNN. I do have to apologize because they did change their headline. They did change their headline on that show. There we go. Intel chiefs presented Justin R. Young with the greatest day of his life. So that is true. That's actually true. CNN, you got it right. This was the greatest day of my life. Thank you so much for now recognizing it. And that's Jake Tapper there on the screen. Letting everybody know that this is something that that has absolutely happened before. So thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you for that. I do appreciate. For audio listeners, somebody edited the headline, and it looks amazing. Go ahead and check out my Twitter. I'm sure we're going to put it there. Donald Trump comes out full of piss and vinegar. Pun intended. Among the stuff that happens, newsworthy, not newsworthy. Newsworthy. Donald Trump says in unequivocal terms that he believes that Russia was behind the hack on the DNC. Says it was probably Russia. Never said that before. Usually said it could be anybody. Could be a 16-year-old, what'd he say, a fat kid, 400-pound man in his basement. That's important. And basically says that, Russia shouldn't have done it. But that hacking is something that happens a lot and we need to take better precautions about it because it's a wider, more robust problem than we would like to admit. I had a really weird time with that part of the speech because I've never heard something that I actually kind of agreed with sound so stupid. Because he has no idea what the hell he's talking about when it comes to technology. He kept talking about how the GOP had a great hacking defense. Like he was like it was a football scheme, right? All right, is our hacking defense a 4-3 or a 3-4? Should we go into nickel? Is it prevent? I don't know. Are we going to blitz on our hacking defense? Like, there's no illuminating technical terms to let us know, what had happened. He never uses terms like, he says things that I think I've been saying on this show for a while, that the DNC was careless about their information and that's why it wound up getting in the wind. John Podesta got spearfished. That is a preventable, common tactic to hack people for things a lot less valuable than information that could swing an election, right? Of course, he just says it in such a weird way, right? He just has this weird way of saying it. He then says that, hey, look, Russia's hacking us. Sure, they shouldn't be doing it, and they should face repercussions for it. But let's understand that if we want to start a Cold War based on this, that we're going to start a war with literally everybody. Because China's hacking us, because other independent groups are hacking us and then selling that information to the highest bidder. We got to be more complicated. I mean, this is a far more complicated situation than just, oh, my God, Russia's the worst. Unprecedented hacking. And also, hacking's a dumb term. So it's like, I kind of agreed with what he was saying. He was just saying it in like, the hacking and the hacking defense and this, that, and the other. It's like, all right, fine, whatever. Cool. Of news, he says he is not releasing his tax returns. Says that the American people don't care about his tax returns, that that only the media cares about his tax returns. I'm actually curious. I'm curious about this. Because his point was, and you kind of can't argue with it, he's like, listen, if people cared about it, then they wouldn't have voted for me because I didn't do it while I was running. So obviously the people don't care about it. The media cares about it.
So here, I'm gonna create a poll on Straw Poll, and I want to ask you guys, do you care about the hacking? I'm curious. I will reveal the end of this at the end. You know, he has the lady come out. The lady walks everything through. But then he does address obliquely, he addresses what we all wanted to know. He addresses the elephant in the room. He addresses the rumors. He says, does anybody actually believe that I did that? And then says, by the way, I'm a real germaphobe. I don't have much of an interest in finding out if this is true. Because also, here's the weird thing that nobody's really talking about with this. Let's say this is true. Let's say that the Russians have videotape of Donald Trump jacking it, just full on rolling the dice, right? While, you know, Bianca and Svetlana just go full emptying the bladder on this frilly Ritz-Carlton bed, right? Now it's less important, right? Blackmail's only important when you are afraid of the consequences. If a report comes out and tells everybody what they're going to see, it's less important than it would have been before, right? Because now he's already faced half the shame. So let's assume in a world that this isn't a 4chan hoax and this isn't just a game of telephone and this is verifiable. And the Russians have this video. It's less valuable now, right? Like, there is, if we really wanted to get Alex Jones about it, you could say that Donald Trump, now assuming power, wants to throw off the yoke of this blackmail, make sure this gets run, so he can take the piss, pun intended, out of this blackmail. I don't think that's true. I think that this is fake. But, because it also just seems too on the nose, right? Like, you know, wouldn't it have been better if, like, it was just him choking a hooker while having sex with her? Or even just having sex with a hooker or getting a blowjob, like, while he's married? Like, that, all of that just seems, like, better, easier blackmail than this. Trump also made a point to say that he, whenever he travels internationally, he's very, very careful about cameras, and that's it. Reverend Buck says, stop kink shaming. I'm not kink shaming. I'm just saying that I would suspect if I were trying to blackmail somebody, that it would be easier to get somebody to do that you'd be able to blackmail them with. Like, so, yeah, I guess acknowledging that people can be blackmailed on their sexual predilections, like, yeah, that's acknowledging a societal truth, I guess. Fitzshiv 29. Do you think Trump's into docking? Who knows? Maybe. I think he'd need, I don't know. Maybe that's the compromising material from his trip to Brazil. Okay. Did we do a good job on that? Is there anything else that we want to that we want to go over? Is there anything else that you guys saw during this that we want to make sure that we go over? I'm not just going to read every kink in the book here, because there is. Listen, we've tried to keep this family friendly for the vast majority of this podcast. This one is not going to be. But, I mean, hell, it's the news. I mean, I'm just doing what I could do. What if Trump and Bill had a docking club? Let's just leave it there. You can email this show, justinrobertyoung@gmail.com. Again, Justin Robert Young. Oh, stop it. No, not Justin Robert Young. TheYoungAmerican@gmail.com. Pat writes, hey, after your segment on South Korean cults and their presidency, I thought you could talk about a different movie genre's antagonist, specifically the 90s action movie bad guy known as Robert Duterte. Apparently, he bragged about throwing politicians from a helicopter and doing drive-by shootings on a motorcycle during a speech to typhoon survivors. His spokesman claims all these stories are urban legends. I don't know if we read that one before, but it's worth reading again. Chopper writes, yesterday I got really frustrated that the Alabama NAACP, not because they staged a sit-in at Jeff Sessions' Mobile office or said that they were not going to leave until he withdrew his nomination, but because some office manager or secretary was going to have to call the police to have them arrested because they just wanted to go home. They have a life outside of working for Senator Jeff Sessions. Senator Jeff Sessions was probable at the first day of the 115th U.S. Congress for getting ready for his confirmation hearings. He wasn't in Mobile. They didn't make his life any worse or harder. Just that poor office manager who had the trudging task of being the last to leave to lock up the office. There are not enough stories about those whose lives are made harder by politics just because they're working for the wrong politician that day. Might be the nice alternative topic to politics, politics, politics. Thanks for letting me rant. And thank you, Trapper. Adam writes, congrats on a stellar 2016, and here's looking forward to even better 2017 for the Jury Empire. I'd like to throw out some hypothetical policy decisions and get your take on their political ramifications. Number one, changing the Electoral College. And number two, nuclear expansion versus disarmament. Number one, the Electoral College has outlived and or failed in its stated purpose to keep an unqualified person out of office, while overperforming at giving certain states undue influence in the general election. But there is also no political will to change it while the GOP is in control, since they've been the sole beneficiaries of its power imbalance. Can you imagine a scenario in which the Electoral College reform is proposed, but set on a delay of 25 years, maybe 50? This would get enough of a blind buffer for neither party to feel disadvantaged by a change to the system. Do you think the Dems would horse trade something big on the GOP wish list to get this done? As an aside, do you think that this delayed implementation strategy would work anywhere else? You want to know what? We're just going to take that. The other thing is the nuclear issue, which I know far less about. So let's just go ahead and say with the Electoral College. I think the Electoral College is a scapegoat. I think that Bush versus Gore was a historically, hilariously close election. And yes, Gore had more of the popular vote, but I think that the will of the people was accurately reflected in Bush versus Gore. And by that, I mean not necessarily the winner, but the fact that it was that close. And I think that Hillary Clinton was a bad candidate. She was such a bad candidate that she let Donald Trump into office. So there seems to me to be two different issues. We can either not let Hillary Clinton run again if you're the Democratic Party, or we can abolish the Electoral College. I'm going to tell you that one way is easier, and in general, these things follow the path of less resistance. David writes, with the craziness in the last few days distracting from everything, I wanted to write down something longer term I had in my head. Trump is Archie Bunker, anti-non-American, anti-union, but also talks up the little guy against big business, tells people he dislikes his ideas to shut up, stifle it, Edith. He won the Archie and Sons and Daughters of Archies in the Rust Belt to win the election. Back to your regularly scheduled broadcast, except for you, CNN. No questions for you. I mean, that is definitely a very musty reference, but I appreciate it. Gma writes, I'm on Twitter, but I use it entirely as a news feed, so I don't at you. But since no one suggested them, here's Joel Gibbs Band during its gay Canadian polysonic spree phase. And that is, of course, on Twitter, I was asking for pee songs, and he gave me the Hidden Cameras' Golden Streams, which is just great. Shiftlock says, and you were worried there wouldn't be enough post-election political news for the podcast. Bah, ha, ha, ha. Well, you know, as much as I didn't necessarily want to talk about Barack Obama's farewell address, this will be, is this the last week or is it next week? I think he gave his farewell address, so we would like to give him our farewell address on the Politics, Politics, Politics show. We got to do it the only way we know how. The only way we know how to celebrate. So I'll tell you what, Barry. You go ahead and leave that suit on. Because when you get in the car after you transfer up the power on the inauguration day, I want you to, you want to bring Michelle. Bring Michelle. Sasha and Malia, they can stay home. Because this is a final approval rating.
Get on the floor if you got that booty.
This is a Gallup poll taken from January 8th to January 10th with 1,500 respondents. Of them, 42% disapprove. But 55%, very respectable, because normally the approval rating falls off a cliff in a lame duck year. It is 55% approval! Your headliner, that is a 13% spread. They approve the first African-American president in history, number 44, Barack Hussein Obama. Adios, senor. Thank you for your service.
Politics, 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 politics.
Of course, if you would like to email the show, it is theyoungamerican@gmail.com. You can buy The Contender, my political card game, at thecontender.us. Music provided by Valesco and Chop Killers. Follow me at Justin R. Young everywhere. I loved you guys reacting to the pole dance last week. Let me know what you think about this show on Snapchat. And of course, you can download archived episodes of this show at BonerWars.com. Remember, some shows talk about politics, others talk about politics. This is the only show that talks about all three. See you next week.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.